the initial impression of the Hit and Miss, it's very nicely machined. All of this looks to be bead blasted. Somebody took their time with assembly. I don't see any scratch marks or anything on the engine at all. It's very clean. Very nice. The Hit and Miss engine is a four-cycle engine. What that means is as the piston travels to the rear, that's the intake stroke, it pulls a vacuum on top of the piston, which opens the poppet valve in the head. That allows air to go through the carburetor and mix with fuel. So you then have an air-fuel mixture on top of the piston. Compression stroke is the next one. As the piston travels forward, it compresses that air-fuel mixture and the spark plug fires. It creates an explosion which powers the piston to the rear. That's the power stroke. The valve right here just starts to open, and as the piston goes forward again, that's the exhaust stroke. So you have intake, compression, power, exhaust, four strokes. It continues to fire until it builds up enough inertia or speed in the flywheel, and this governor system starts to expand due to the centrifugal force. And that is controlled by the weight of these two pieces of brass and the springs. As that opens up, it allows this mechanism to come up and block the exhaust valve. It holds the exhaust valve open. As long as the exhaust valve is being held open, this just freewheels until it slows down. The governor starts to close and it allows the exhaust valve to function again. So occasionally it will fire to maintain momentum. Then the exhaust valve is held open and it will coast until once again the exhaust valve is allowed to close. So Hit and Miss. The timing of the ignition spark is caused by a magnet that's pressed into the backside of this disc. And that magnet comes around and passes in front of this Hall effect sensor, which triggers a spark to the spark plug. As the piston comes up on compression, that magnet is approaching the sensor. We're at top dead center, the magnet's not quite there yet. Across over top dead center, the magnet's there, triggers a spark, which causes combustion, or what I previously called an explosion. Basically, it is an explosion. And pushes this piston back for the power stroke. There's a hole in this disc, and that's there to line up with the mounting screw that's in here for the Hall effect sensor. You could get in there and loosen that screw to adjust the sensor position. That shouldn't be necessary. And the magnet is located directly opposite the hole in the disc. And the magnet's right there. When I opened the box that this was shipped in, this packing foam was shoved down on here pretty tight. And it was pushing on this tank. The mounting plate for the tank was attached to this quarter inch thick piece of pine with these two screws. When I foam pushed on that, the screws cracked that wood out. So I took that apart and I shoved some epoxy down in those cracks and clamped it together and cleaned it up. And I made this plywood mounting bracket. Just glued it onto the side of this box. Those screws go down into that quarter inch plywood. That's very firm now. You can pick up this whole motor by that. This actually started on the second or third flip when I first tried to run it. It takes a little while to learn where this needle valve needs to be, and I'm sure every carburetor will be slightly different. You want to make sure that you oil all rotating and sliding parts on this thing. This will be a bit of a oily mess. You just have to clean it up every time you run it. Currently, I don't have any water in this. Every time this is missing or coasting, the exhaust valve is being held open. This is just drawing air in and out through the cylinder, which tends to cool it. I give this thing a couple of flips, and I turn it on. Nothing wrong with that. That's a very nice model engine. Very nice. This is a very nicely made and running model engine. If you're interested in this engine, there's a link for this in the description below this video. Give it a couple of flips